narrative is one that was introduced by Bruce Sterling, who's a design thinker, a science fiction author, a design researcher, in a book called Shaping Things. And in this book, he described a number of historical transitions that are happening that I'll call Sterling transitions, after Bruce Sterling. And to summarize this narrative, he would have said that relationships, or he does say in the book, that relationships between humans and technology create cultural transitions which can't be undone. So there were, in the book, he describes five major technocultures that have existed over time. The first technoculture in this narrative was when the people had roles like hunters and farmers, and the technology had roles that he calls artifacts. In this stage, literacy is not important to society. People that do jobs like scribes or initial data managers are very expensive. Life is lived very close to nature, and life is dominated by the rhythms of the seasons. One way is in which the first technoculture in which humans and technology interacted. The next major technoculture in this progression, in this narrative of technology, was when customers used machines. So now the people who are using the technology are more like customers. They are literate and they're numerate. Money as a technology is very widely, if not universally, used. And roads, ships, banks, or infrastructures and institutions are present. And the machines that the customers are using are largely powered by fossil fuels and are mass-produced, or machine-produced. The next technoculture, the third one, is when consumers, the people are now consumers, and the technology are products. This is when goods are available in what is, appears to be infinite quantity. These are the products. These products, these goods, are commodities, and they are they're highly specialized. So you can get high-end and low-end products, high-end and low-end refrigerators, high-end and low-end cars, high-end and low-end clothes. And the consumers exist within information infrastructure. So now, as a person, you're not just buying high-end and low-end things. You also are referenced by a credit history, by social security numbers, by driver's license, by retirement plans. And these data infrastructures and these technological infrastructures intertwine in this technoculture. The current technoculture, or maybe the one in which we're moving into, is the fourth one, in which the people are end users and the technology are gizmos. In this technoculture, gizmos have unreal amounts of functionality. Think of your smartphone, where you can download an app that does anything. You can upgrade your technology to have limitless numbers of features. Everything, though, is tied in relatively unstable information networks. Your mobile, the network comes and goes, power comes and goes, your who's using the phone changes, and you as an end user are constantly being bombarded with information and enticements to participate in the gizmo's infrastructure. So the gizmos are trying to get you as an end user to participate in the information economy that they're in. The last technoculture in Sterling's transition are when people are now called wranglers and the objects are now called spines. And this is something that I would say we're transitioning into now. Wranglers are people who are skilled at finding and using information. And the objects, the physical objects, are actually being replaced by digital equivalents, which Sterling coins the term spine to describe. For example, 3D printing. When you print an object, what you're doing is you're making something which is digital, a spine, real. And what's more important is that digital object, not the thing that you printed. And information now flows between spines and wranglers very, very fluidly. The important thing that Sterling brings out in his description of this narrative of technology is that you move from one technoculture to another technoculture under two instances. One is the line of empire, and the line of empire says that if you don't adopt a new technology, you're going to be overtaken militarily by a culture that does. So imagine the technology of arrows. If you are one society that uses arrows and another society decides to use guns, and you don't also adopt the technology of guns because you can't or you won't, then you're going to fall victim to the society that does. The same thing with when sail transportation, sailboats, progress to steam transportation or fossil fuel-based water transportation. That's one way in which you transition from one technoculture to another. The other way in which you transition from one technoculture to another is by going through the line of no return. And the line of no return is less military. It says that the survival of your society depends on using this new technology. And without it, you're going to have widespread devastation. So think about the transition from using horses to using cars. Sure, you can get out of your car and go ride a horse, but you're not going to be able to keep the infrastructure of things that have goods flowing to Walmart and things coming from the shipping ports and you going back and forth to work. That's not going to work if everyone goes back to horses. You've transitioned through a line of no return. Another example is moving from kerosene to electricity. Okay. Sterling transitions then move forward, and you can't go backwards through them. It's worth thinking about, what are the technologies that we're transitioning through now? What are the technologies that we can't live without? GPS, cell phones, truck transportation. What are the new lines of no return that we can't move backwards from because it would result in widespread devastation, or we'd fall victim to some sort of military overtaking? So the third narrative, a way of thinking about the history of technology transformation, is through Stirling transitions. The relationships between humans and technologies pass through one-way transitions, and Stirling described five of them. The final narrative that I want to put out there, this is a final and fourth way of thinking about the transitions, the way in which IT develops, a story that we tell about what's progress, is one that we have thought about a little bit. Bonnie, Bill, and I, it's called collapse informatics. And collapse informatics says that current technology depends on non-renewable resources. Now, we still have resources now, and so the challenge of collapse informatics is to say, how can we best use the resources that we have now to ensure prosperity when those non-renewable resources are gone? So here are four narrative visions of the future: technological determinism, ubiquitous computing, Stirling transitions, and collapse informatics. Which of these are compatible? And if you think about progress from each of these different perspectives, what sorts of next steps look like progress if you think about the history of technology as being one of ubiquitous computing? What next step looks like progress if you think about the history of technology as being collapse informatics? Are those next steps the same? And if not, why not? And as a student of technology, which of those narratives do you think is more valid? And which of the next steps do you think is actually progress? And which do you think is falling prey to a narrative that isn't applicable today? Thank you very much.